Thanks. Welcome everyone to my presentation. My name is Marcin Zajączkowski. I'll be talking about mutation testing. I have been fascinated by the computers since childhood, and I have dealt with many different IT-related things. To cut a long story short, I have been professionally creating software for more than 8 years. And at some point, I came to the conclusion I'm not satisfied with the way it is created. I started looking for the solutions which would allow me to create more reliable software and have clean, testable, and maintainable code. It led me to the software test machine movement and the techniques related to automatic code testing. I started using it in my work, and it proved to be so effective and useful that I decided to share this knowledge with others so everyone could benefit. And I run workshops, trainings, and speak at conferences. Hence my presence here in Brno. I have two questions for you. Who of you have been heard about mutation testing before? Okay, three people. Okay, who have heard about mutation testing before? Three people, and who have used or use mutation testing? No one. Okay, that's good. During presentation, I will show what mutation testing is and how it works. I will explain why it's not widely known and used, and I will present a tool which has a chance to change it. And next, I will show how mutation testing looks like in practice, and how to prepare your project for using it. To present mutation testing, I will use a metaphor. For next few minutes, we will move in time and space. The second part of 19th century, the group of over 100 settlers from Europe heading west in their wagons by the expanse of Great Plains searching for a place in which they could live and work in peace along with their families. They founded a city called Projectville. They built their houses and started growing plants and raised animals. They were a peaceful community, so there was order in town. The town was growing, thanks to the reputation, it attracted people from the other people from the area who wanted who was seeking peace. Unfortunately, places like this often attract also people who wish to enrich themselves at the expense of others. Residents stopped dealing with crime, and the town council decided to hire professional law enforcement officers. Their task was to patrol the city, reacting to crime, catching guilties, and helping to ensure the situation no longer repeats. The sheriffs quickly brought order back. Everything was fine, but there are still some places where people did not feel safe. The town council introduced patrol paths which help to find places which sheriffs do not visit. The modified patrol plan ensured that all citizens could feel safe. Everything was okay, but after some time there appeared a suspicion that not all sheriffs faithfully did their job. And they would prefer to not notice the crime and walk away, not to risk. There was an idea to hire the second sheriff team to watch the first, but in the end, the town council decided to introduce provocations. From time to time, fake crime was committed to check if it was properly detected and routed. This helped to find sheriffs, dishonest sheriffs, and replace them with the new faithful ones. Now you are probably wondering what is the relationship between 19th century settlers and programming. And I have a quiz for you. Please raise your hand who knows the answer. What are the names of two guys on the below, on the lower picture? I see no hands. So maybe you are too young. They are Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie, the guys heavily involved in the development of the first Unix system. So now let's listen another more contemporary story. A group of experienced professionals started a joint project. They wanted to live in the way that satisfies them while wanted to ensure a maintenance of their families. And now the question for you, what is the relationship, what is the analogy to project in the story about settlers? You can speak loudly. Analogy to project in the story about settlers. I heard town? Yes, it's town. The project, there were quality-oriented professionals and there was no problem with quality. Occasionally found bugs were discussed and the conclusion were drawn. What is an analogy to bugs in code in the story about settlers? Yes, crime. Great crimes. The project got initial success, gained additional funding, and new developer and the expectation of rapid growth. New developers were hired, but they were not so experienced and quality-oriented like the founders. And there were many bugs found in production. And the team introduced automatic code testing, which allowed to find more bugs earlier. What is an analogy to automated tests? Sheriffs, great. The situation was improved, but there were still places where there were still modules where bugs were detected too late. The team introduced code coverage to find those places and improve test for specific modules. What is what is analogy to code coverage? Yes, battle paths or plan of patrols. Okay, it helped again, but then after some time, there were found bugs in production, which could and should be detected by existing tests. After the investigation, it turned out that some developers do not want to write high quality code and just write tests to fulfill the minimum required level of code coverage. The team introduced mutation testing. In this technique, the selected line is modified, and malicious code is introduced in given line. And for example, we change equal to not equal, and we change incrementation to decrementation. Then we run tests against given change to check if this change is detected by test. If any of the tests fails, then this change was covered and everything is okay. So tell me, what is the analogy to mutants or ENCODE in the story about settlers? Yes, fake crimes or provocations. Okay, because it's the key part, let's summarize what is mutation testing. In mutation testing, we take a given line and introduce a mutation, so we change it intentionally. For example, we can remove given line. And then we run our test to check if this change is detected. So if a test, if any of tests will fail. Next, in the situation that mutation survived, so was not detected, it is a potential bug which would not be detected by automatic tests when introduced accidentally in the future during the development. This is a very interesting idea. It was first proposed in 1971. Now you may wondering even more why after 40 years it's not commonly known and used. The key problem are tools, or in general the problem with implementation of the conception of mutation testing. For Java environment, there are only a few projects, and more of them are abundant. This is mostly because the fact that the projects are usually scientific projects, and after the graduation, they are abundant by the authors. Another problem is long execution time. In mutation testing, we have to inspect every line in our code to check if there is a possibility to introduce a modification. If yes, In the pessimistic scenario, all tests from our test suite have to be run after any modification in every line for every class in our project. So usually there is a lot of test execution, a lot of executions of tests, which was problematic, especially in the past where the computation power was very limited. Another problem, especially in the project without version control system, what was not unusual even several years ago, that production code has to be modified, which could be risky. And the introduction of mutation testing can be problematic itself. For example, if you have a for loop and we change incrementation to decrementation of A, then we could make this loop infinite. Similar situation is with recursion and a Stack Overflow problem. PEAT is a mutation testing tool for Java environment. One of its main advantages is speed. PEAT, it was achieved thanks to a few used techniques. First of all, PEAT operates on bytecode, which is much faster than changing a source code and recompiling them. In addition, PEAT optimizes the execution, and before the mutation testing phase, it calculates standard code coverage. Thanks to this provided information, allow PEAT to check if a given line is executed by any test. If no test executes a given line, there is no sense to introduce mutation in a given line. So it can be skipped. In addition, thanks to the standard code coverage measurement, PEAT can narrow a scope of tests run against given modification. For example, if only five tests execute a given line, there is no sense to run all the suite of 500 tests for a given change. So it can improve the speed of mutation testing. PEAT supports also parallel execution. It can run mutation testing in multiple threads, and it doesn't scale linear, but the speedup is pretty visible on quad-core or even dual-core processor, which is a standard for the development workstation nowadays. Since last spring, PEAT supports also incremental analysis. After the mutation testing, PEAT writes down the results to the file, and before the consecutive execution, PEAT can check if there were any changes in the introduced in the code. If not, PEAT just skipped mutation testing analysis. In addition, it even if there were some changes, PEAT can narrow the scope of mutation testing to only modified production classes and modified automatic tests. PEAT provides several mutation out of box, and for example, we can change expressions in the conditional expression. We can change equal to not equal, or for example, change greater than or equal to greater than. It allows to detect problems with coverage of the boundaries. PEAT has a set of mutators. For example, we can change incrementation to decrementation or modified assignment value. PEAT also can influence on returned value. For example, instead of return full, it will return null or just throw runtime exception. There is also useful group of mutators which remove the execution of given line, which is especially useful for testing of side effects verification. PEAT has a rich ecosystem. Out of box, it allows to be run from Maven and command line. 2 years ago, I wrote a plugin for Gradle build system. The mutation testing results can be browsed from IDE, and there is no problem with popular unit testing frameworks in Java. Last but not least, there is also a young plugin for Sonar, currently Sonar Cubes, Sonar Cube, which allows to integrate results from PEAT into the violation issue system in Sonar. So we can simply browse Sonar results together with other things covered by Sonar. To summarize, PEAT is fast, powerful, and can be used from whatever you want, almost. Alternatives. Unfortunately, there is no real alternative to PEAT. Java Launch, it's quite interesting, but has a small ecosystem and there was no development done recently. Java is another quite interesting problem, but there is no free access to source code. Another projects which I have found are no longer maintained. I took a look for other languages, and for Python, PHP, and Ruby, there are quite interesting libraries. There was something even for .NET. Okay, now let's look how mutation testing looks like in practice. I took a simple project, app info library, And we will run a standard code coverage for the code. Especially interesting for us is simpler manifest application info Java file. As you can see, this is the last blue class. There is 100% line coverage in this class, so everything should be fine. But we will run a PID against this project. I have used here my plugin for Gradle, but it can be used in a similar way from Maven command line and so on. Okay, the project is really small, but it took a while, 8 seconds to make a mutation testing. PID executed 164 tests. And let's check the results. Okay, PID shows that there is 100% line coverage, but there is some survived mutation. We can check it. The dark green lines are the lines where mutation was introduced. Here, one mutation. Light green lines are the lines with standard code coverage where the mutation PID was unable to introduce mutation, and red lines with survived mutations. Mutation, yes. We can see that PID just removed that line, and the mutation survive changes was not detected. Okay, and, we should do some investigation, but I already did it. And there were missing two assertions in code. We can run PID again, this time without clean, to show how incremental analysis looks like in practice. This time it took only 1 second, and only 31 tests were run against the code base. PID detected that there was only small changes in code in the meantime. I refreshed the results and mutation was killed. This is only a short presentation about how PID looks like in practice. If you like it, you can ask organizers in a survey to invite me in the next year to make a workshop from PID. Okay, let's switch to our presentation. Okay. I show you how mutation testing looks like, and now you could ask what can you get from mutation testing. And first of all, it provides information how good your tests really are and how much you can rely on them. Mutation testing points places which are not properly tested and where more tests should be written or all tests should be improved. This led to the situation that the code quality is better and there are less bugs found in production. When you can use mutation testing tools? There are many projects where a lot of bugs found in production are treated as something normal. I think it's not normal, and I try to write my code in the way that helps to find more bugs during development. I think there are many people which try to do the same. And for those people and those teams, the mutation testing tools is the very useful tool to find bugs, potential bugs earlier. There are also projects where in which high quality is required by the domain it is placed. For example, algo trading projects, military projects, or medical projects. And in those projects, bugs in production can lead to huge financial loss on loss in credibility. In those projects, mutation testing can be especially useful as well. Another use case is the situation when we have high quality, high code, high code coverage, but there are still bugs found in production which should be detected by our tests. If we have doubts about our test quality, we can use speed to check how good our tests are. And another use case is the work with legacy systems where there is low code quality, probably there are no tests, but we would like to change this project, to write a new test, to refactor the project. And the mutation testing can help us to detect places which are still not covered by our new test and where those tests should be written. Okay, how you can prepare your project for using mutation testing? First of all, you have to write automatic tests. It's a mandatory requirement. But if you have tests, even though integration tests and acceptance tests are useful and can detect a lot of interesting bugs, in my opinion, the core of your test suite should be based on unit tests. They are fast, can be run in parallel, and can precisely test all the low-level cases related to your code base. In the situation you have both fast unit tests and slow integrations tests, it's important to have an ability to run only a selected group of them. For example, if you have the only way to run a test in your project is Maven test, which takes 15 minutes. It's only a matter of time when the developers will start to use the deskip test flag, and this test will be run very rarely. So it's mutation testing can be run. Mutation testing can be used with integration tests, but it's it provides best results, usually, especially due to a long execution time with unit tests. It's also important to have a separation in TDD when you would like to run only unit tests very, very often. Could ask, can it be useful? Can it be used in a real life project? And I can say that yes. Companies don't like to price software they are using, but there are at least two companies which brag that they used mutation testing, PEAT in this case, and they were satisfied with the way it helped them to create more reliable software. The British Sky Broadcasting is the largest pay TV broadcaster in UK, and The Ladders, the job-seeking company popular especially in US. In case you will be using mutation testing, I encourage you to write about it on your blog or on the mailing list to spread the word that mutation testing can be used in real-life projects. Let's summarize the benefits of using mutation testing. First of all, it allows to verify the effectiveness of your tests. You have a clear overview how good your tests really are and if they are able to detect faults in your code. Or if your tests just pretend to testing something, but in fact provide no added value and only absorb your time to maintain them. This leads to a more readable code with less bugs and less and for example, you can it can allow you to sleep a sound instead of deploying emergency fixes on production at 4 a.m. Yes, this in turn can lead to many interesting aspects. I wrote down three things which are important for me. First of all, less troubles at work. Things usually just work. In addition, I definitely prefer to do things which are which develop my skills and which are interesting for me instead of have a never-ending story with bugs which when fixing one bug generates three more due to unmaintainable and poorly written code. I would like to write code which satisfies me and which I could publicly show without fears. It had to give me a satisfaction and the feeling I'm doing a good job. What is something I wish you to? Thanks for listening. Okay, maybe you have any questions? Me? In the meantime, I remind you that there is an ability to give feedback. You can use this QR code or use a button which is in the schedule. Yes.
I have probably two or three questions. So first of all, you have mentioned that you have some success stories that mutation testing is used. My question is how big were the projects for which mutation testing was used? Was it just estimation of a number of line of codes or for example how long the tests are running, etc.?
Okay, I don't remember what was exactly the number of lines of code, but yes, as far as I remember, one of this project was a project created by a group of five people during 4 or 6 in 5 or 6 months. So I think it's quite big project, and in my presentation there are links to blogs of those two companies, so it can be written more detailedly how big the projects were. Okay, the question was how negative impacts on tests, for example, or on code like infinite loops are handled by Pete. And Pete tries to detect the situation that the mutation will generate code that would not be code which, for example, will loop itself, but in case there were some mutation which introduce infinite loop, Pete check how long was the execution of given test. And Pete allows to run this test, for example, for 3 times longer than usual, and later it cancel this execution. And this parameter can be customized, for example, for integration tests where this variation can be higher.
And last question: have you ever tried to use it, for example, in Jenkins CI tool? So there is a plugin or whatever to integrate the results from it to be shown in Jenkins UI.
Okay, the question was about using PEET in with Jenkins to present the results. And I haven't seen a plugin for Jenkins, but there are at least two workarounds. For example, there's no problem with running PEET from, for example, Jenkins, because it can be used with JUnit, SNG, or Spock. So there is just from Maven or from Gradle, you can run this as another task. And PEET generates the results. The results by default are in HTML format, but can be written down in XML format. And you can, for example, use a plugin for Jenkins to link results, link to the results of PEET. But generally, another workaround is to use Sonar, because Sonar can integrate results from Waris tools, then it can also show mutation results of mutation testing analysis.
Okay, one more question. And as you told, the mutation happens on bytecode level.
Yes.
So does it mean that mutation testing could be used for any non-Java language that runs in JVM?
Yes, there is a problem with this. PEET currently only works on Java, on Java, on for Java in, with Java projects. Tests can be written, for example, with Spock in Groovy, because bytecode which executes another bytecode is okay for PEET, but bytecode of production bytecode cannot be from Groovy or Scala. And it's a known limitation, and the author of PEET created a project called Fault Seed, and it's a commercial branch of PEET, which provides another mutation testing engine, and it, when developed, will allow to use to generate mutation testing also for Groovy and Scala.
Just run a bit against that, and I'd like to know how long would it take for a medium-sized, for example, 100,000 lines of code project, how long will, with normal test coverage, how long will the execution time take?
Mm-hmm. The question was, which did I try to use it with open source project to check how long it takes? No, I didn't eat personally, but there were some reports by did by author of PEET, which tested with different frameworks, and usually he was able to detect bugs in his code thanks to using different open source projects. I think I don't know how would it take for a project like you mentioned, but I think it is a matter of in the medium-sized project, it's a matter of below an hour. But generally, thanks to parallel execution and thanks to incremental analysis, you can reduce cost of consecutive executions. Another question? Mm-hmm.
Because the number of possible mutations is exponential. Right? Yeah, if I take a piece of code, there are very large number of possible mutations that can be done.
Mm-hmm. Yes, the question was the parallel execution in PEET, what does it mean? If it's on the level of running tests in parallel or about introducing mutation in parallel. And as far as I know, it's at the level of introducing mutation. So you can introduce different mutation and run different tests for different mutation in the same time. So it's not only like a GenUnit in parallel execution that you can run a different test in the same time, but Pete can also introduce different mutations and work and parallel this work as well. Okay, we are run out of time, so thank you again.
Yes.